Welcome, everybody. So, good morning or good afternoon. And so, today's session will start with a talk of Charlotte Christiansen of the Niels Bohr Institute. And she will talk about titles changed a little bit, duality relations for overlaps of integrable boundary states in ADS CFT. Please, Charlotte.
Okay. Thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you very much for inviting me to give this talk. Also, thanks a lot to all the people who tuned in and out there in cyberspace. So, as just mentioned, the title of my talk will be Duality Relations for Overlaps of Integrable Boundary States in ADS CFT. And of course, duality relations are at the very heart of ADS CFT, but the relations that I will talk about will not be the usual, so to say, macroscopic duality relations, but rather a novel set of microscopic duality relations. Well, they are actually not really novel. They pertain to the underlying integrable superspin chain of ADS CFT, but they have some novel implications for overlaps between involving boundary states, which are of importance for the ADS CFT correspondence. And the work that I will be speaking about was done in collaboration with Dennis Müller and Konstantin Zaremba, and can be found in these three papers, of which the last one appeared just this morning in the archive. Okay, so what is my motivation for these studies? Well, what I want to do is, as I said, that I want to exploit some microscopic dualities within ADS CFT, which pertain to the underlying integrable superspin chain of ADS CFT. More precisely, I'm interested in overlaps between spin chain eigenstates and certain boundary states. More precisely, matrix product states or valence bond states, because such overlaps, they encode information about correlation functions in ADS CFT. Primarily about one-point functions, but also about other types of correlation functions. The same type of overlaps are also interesting for the study of quantum quintets in statistical mechanics. There one sets out a quantum system in an initial state, which is not a simple eigenstate of the system or a simple linear combination of eigenstates. And then one lets the system evolve and studies its time development. There, in that connection, the boundary state plays a role of the initial state of the quench. Now, the microscopic dualities that I want to talk about, they can be separated into fermionic dualities and bosonic dualities. And the fermionic dualities, they allow us to move between the different thinking diagrams of the underlying super-Lie algebra describing my integrable spin chain.
Sorry if I interrupt you. Are you moving the slides? I think we are still on the first slide, right? Okay.
Really?
Yeah, now we see a slide entitled Motivation, but...
Well, that's strange. But now I'm not full screen.
Right. No, you are not.
Okay, let me try to see.
So maybe it might help to unshare and then go to full screen and then share.
So now you see my motivation?
Yes, it's not full screen, but we see your motivation slide.
Okay, that's strange. Oops, I'll try once more.
So if you first go to full screen and then share, it might help.
Okay, let me do that. Work on my side. You see my motivation now?
No, I think you should share the screen.
Yeah, okay, my screen share did not work. Sorry. Oops.
Right, we see your motivation slide now.
Can you label it without full screen?
Yeah, it's visible, yes.
I think, I don't know why it crashed when I tried to share the full screen. Let me continue here instead.
That's fine.
Okay, very good. Sorry about that. Okay, so I have these two sets of dualities that are bosonic and fermionic. And the fermion dualities, they allow me to move between different thinking diagrams of the underlying super Lie algebra. The bosonic dualities do not have a similar interpretation, but they sort of complete the possible set of dualities and exhaust all what we have of these microscopic dualities. And one hope is also that these various duality relations might help us to constrain possible overlap formulas. Okay. So first, this is plan of the rest of my talk. So I will start by explaining how these overlaps appear in ADS-CFT. Then I will review what we know about the structure of such overlap formulas from concrete computations. And then these two parts, they contain our main results. Here I investigate how the overlap formulas behave under fermionic dualities as well as under bosonic dualities and try to see what we learn from that. And I can already now reveal that the overlaps which are of relevance for ADS-CFT, they have very nice covariant transformation properties under the fermionic duality relations, but more about that later. And at the end, I will of course give a summary and suggest some possible future directions of investigation. Okay, so first let me explain how all this with overlaps fits into ADS-CFT. So the ADS-CFT correspondence is a framework which relates a four-dimensional quantum field theory to a 10-dimensional string theory. And it comes with a dictionary which relates the good conformal operators on the field theory side to the string states in the string theory side. And we have learned that a way to move from one side to another is to identify the good conformal operators as well as the string states with the eigenstates of an integrable superspin chain. And I will denote such eigenstates as U in the following. Now we can consider a defect version of ADS-CFT, where on the field theory side, we introduce a three-dimensional defect, a codimension one defect, placed for instance at set equals zero. That will then on the string theory side correspond to introducing a probe brain. That probe brain will have to share three dimensions with the four-dimensional boundary of ADS-5, and then that way give rise to the defect on the field theory side. Now one can, on both sides, introduce a boundary state which describes respectively the defect and the probe brain. And this boundary state can be given a very explicit expression in the spin chain language. So let me say a few words about the spin chain language then. So I start from the simplest possible example of an integrable spin chain, namely the Heisenberg spin chain. So this spin chain, it encodes the good conformal single trace operators of n equals 4 super Jahn Mills, which are built from two complex fields that we can call X and Y. And it comes with an obvious mapping that the fields X are mapped to spin up in the spin chain and fields Y are mapped to spin down. So the Heisenberg spin chain is a one-dimensional quantum mechanical system, a chain where on each side we have a spin 1/2 variable, and we take the chain to be closed. And each eigenstate of the chain is then in one-to-one correspondence with a good conformal operator built from two complex scalars. And a given eigenstate with k excitation, meaning k y fields on a sea of x fields, is then described by k variables, so-called beta roots, which have to fulfill a set of beta equations. And they look like this. And the norm of the eigenstate can be found in a very beautiful way as a determinant of a matrix. That matrix is known as the Gödel matrix, and its kth element is simply the derivative of this function, chi k, which appears here, with respect to the root uj. And this Gödel matrix, it will play a very prominent role in the following. Okay, but to describe n equals 4 super Jahn Mills, we need a spin chain with much more symmetry. But unfortunately, it's possible to formulate an integrable nearest neighbor spin chain for any Lie group of the type SUM/N. All one needs is the Cartang matrix of the Lie algebra, and then a Dinkin label which defines the representation of the spin variable that you're interested in. Then you can write down the beta equations directly. And these indices on the Cartang matrix and the Dinkin labels, they can run from 1 up to m plus n minus 1, which is also equal to the number of nodes in the Dinkin label. And for each node, there's a type of beta root. And each type of beta root can occur a number of times, which we can call Ka if the roots are called Ua. In the same way as before, the eigenstates are in one-to-one correspondence with good conformal operators of the field theory if we take this group appropriately. And in the same way as before, we can define or we can calculate the norm of the beta eigenstate by means of a Gödel matrix, which is also defined as before. We have to differentiate this function in the exponent chi aj with respect to the root u bk, say. Okay. And if we want to apply this to n equals 4 super Young Mills theory, we have to use m and n equal to 4. And that corresponds to a Dinkin diagram, which has 7 nodes. And for super Lie algebra, it's possible to choose different Dinkin diagrams. The one which has been most used is in latest times is the one which has an alternating grading where the nodes are alternating between bosonic and fermionic, and where there is a Dinkin label associated with the middle node. And I should say that a node which has a Dinkin label associated with it is denoted as a momentum carrying node. In the early days of AJS CFT interoperability, one also worked with two other Dinkin diagrams for the Lie algebra, namely some which were called the Beauty and the Beast. But all of them give valid descriptions, and they play all of them a prominent role in the following. Okay, so now I can move back to the concept of integrable boundary states. So a boundary state is a spin chain state, at least in the one spin chain language, and they can sometimes be integrable. And what I mean by an integrable boundary state in this context is a boundary state for which the overlap with any beta eigenstate can be computed in a closed form. And by explicit computations, we have found a number of the boundary states which fulfill this criterion. And they fall in two classes. Some are so-called matrix product states and some are valence bond states. In matrix, to define a matrix product state, you associate with each spin state in the spin chain a matrix. And then you define a spin chain state as a sum over all spin configurations, where a certain configuration is weighted by the trace of the product of the corresponding matrices. That is one type of boundary state that appears to be integrable. And another one is a so-called valence bond states. They are states which are formed by composing two-side states. So they are two-side product states with some coefficients that can depend on the spin configuration. So we have found some integrable states of that type, and we also understood why they're integrable from a scattering perspective. It namely turns out that these states can be viewed as a superposition of excitation pairs, which come with plus and with momenta plus and minus p, which is equivalent to no creation of excitations at the boundary, only reflection. And in the spin chain language, that can be expressed as the boundary state being annihilated by all the parity or conserved charges of the spin chain. Okay. So let me try to explain how these two classes of boundary states appear in the ADS-CFT setup. So they appear when we, as I explained before, introduce a defect on the field theory side, a three-dimensional one, which separates the space-time into two regions with different ranks of the gauge group, UN minus K on one side and UN on the other side, where UN is, strictly speaking, only the symmetry group far away from the defect, whereas at finite distances, the gauge group is also broken to UN minus K on this side here. On the string theory side, that corresponds to a situation where you have a single probe D5 brain, which is inserted in the background of the usual D3 brains. And then K of the D3 brains is being dissolved in the D5 brain, giving rise to the difference in the rank of the gauge group in the field theory side. Now, the way the symmetry is broken on the right-hand side in the field theory side is via some of the classical fields of N equals 4 super Young Mills attaining a non-trivial vacuum expectation value. More precisely, there's a setup where three of the six scalar fields get a vacuum expectation value, which looks like this. There's a 1 over x3 out in front, where x3 is the distance to the defect. And then there's a k times k matrix here in the upper left-hand corner. And the three TIs, they constitute a k-dimensional irreducible representation of issue 2. Such a solution is permitted by the classical equations of motion of N equals 4 super Young Mills theory. And one can show up that the resulting field theory constitutes a defect CFT and that it's also supersymmetric. And it constitutes one of the cases which was studied by Gallardo and Witten in the famous paper from 2008. Okay. Now, in such a defect CFT, one can have non-vanishing one-prime functions, and they are restricted to take a particular form, which was shown by Cardi back in the 80s. So a one-prime function of a bulk operator with conformal dimension delta must take this form here, where x3 is the distance to the defect, delta is the conformal dimension of the bulk operator, and c is some structure constant that we have to compute. Now, due to the lefts, the scalar operators, they can have non-zero one-prime functions already at three level. So we find these one-prime functions by taking our good conformal operator and replacing fields inside by the classical vacuum expectation values. Now, in general, the good conformal operators are complicated linear combinations of single trace operators, but we know exactly those linear combinations thanks to the integrability of the system. More precisely, the good conformal scalar operators, they are eigenstates of the integrable SO6 spin chain, which is the result of a famous paper by Minahan and Sorrento from 2002. Now, to compute these one-point functions, we can introduce a matrix product state associated with the defect. And now we check for each of the scalar fields and associate a matrix, which is the representation matrix appearing in the classical field from before. So it's only non-zero for the fields phi 1, phi 2, and phi 3. And then we define a matrix product state as a spin chain state where some or all spin configurations and each expansion coefficient is a trace of the corresponding representation matrices. Then we can compute the eigenfunction, the one-point function of our operators by this recipe here. You have to take the inner product between the beta eigenstate representing the operator and the matrix product state, because what this matrix product state does is that it picks out the terms in the beta eigenstate with the same combination of fields, and then it replaces those terms by the trace of the corresponding representation matrices. And that is, it implements exactly the recipe that we have up here. And then we also have to divide by the norm of the beta eigenstates. So this is why the matrix product state appears as a boundary state in ADS 15. Now let me say something about why the valence bond state also appears. It appears in the special case where K is equal to 1, where we have only a difference in rank of 1 between the two sides of the defect. Then we don't have any vacuum expectation values, but it's still natural to split the components of the n cross n fields in this way here, because of the difference in rank of the gauge groups on the two sides of the defect. So here is what the fields on the right-hand side would look like. And then we can impose that not all the components of the field propagate on both sides of the defect by introducing some boundary conditions on the fields in the first row here and the first column here. And we have to impose boundary conditions in a particular way if we want to keep to the symmetry. And that's also something that was worked out by Kyoto and Witten. So the major part of the field components do not get any boundary conditions at the defect, but all the fields in the first row and the first column, it's either Dirichlet or Neumann boundary conditions according to some recipe which conserves supersymmetry. Now, with those boundary conditions, one can write down the scalar propagators in a compact way if one introduces a constant kappa, which is one for Neumann, minus one for Dirichlet, and zero for no boundary conditions. Then the scalar propagators become a sum of two terms, where in the second term, there's an X bar appearing, which is the mirror image of X. And that means that one can actually contract complex fields of the same type if one contracts field components which correspond to the first row or the first column. Namely, we can make a complex combination of a field with Neumann boundary condition and the Schlick boundary condition. And if we compute the correlator for such, or the contraction rule for such a field, we find that in order to get something non-vanishing, one of the field components has to be a one, and the remaining ones are contracted with the usual delta function, which appear for matrix contractions. And then we have the space-time dependence, which is x bar minus y, which is something which tells us that this propagator is non-vanishing and non-singular, even if the complex fields are of the same type, which is normally not the case. Normally, you have to contract a complex field, which is complex conjugate. But you can also contract fields at the same points because this propagator here is non-singular when x goes to 5. And that is important when we want to compute one-point functions in this k equals one setup. Because since we have no classical refs, we have to compute the one-point functions by honest weak contractions. And here I have tried to depict the weak contractions that one can do. They have to appear inside a single trace operator, which is represented by this circle. And each double line which ends on the circle corresponds to a field inside the single trace operator. Then, as usual, to get something which is leading in the planar limit, one has to contract neighboring fields like this, whereas contractions where you contract non-neighboring fields, they are subleading in the planar limit. There's only one additional rule compared to normal, namely that this index, which has to be a one, it has to run in the ring, and the independent indices, A, they have to run in these small circles to optimize, to maximize the power of N. But that our weak contractions look like this means that we exactly can calculate the one-point function of a good performer operator by taking the inner product of corresponding beta eigenstate with a valence bond state. Because the valence bond state, if we make it in the H2 case, as a sum of the two side states of type XX plus YY, then it implements exactly this type of contraction. It picks out the combination of the eigenstates which have neighboring identical fields, and then it replaces them by the result of the contraction, which actually just gives a factor out front that I have left out. And this is the simplest example of a valence bond state which appears in ADS CFT, but there are more advanced valence bond states, for instance, one here, which you get in the so-called HU2/3 sector of N equals 4 superlambdas, where you have three complex scalars and two fermions. In this valence bond state, there's a minus for the fermionic two side states. And that is something which comes out when you divide the contraction rules based on the correct supersymmetric boundary conditions. So this is why these types of boundary states are important in ADS-CFT. They're also important because one can use them as initial steps when one wants to prove overlap formulas for the matrix product states. But more about that later. Okay, let me now turn to presenting some overlap formulas. And these are some formulas which have been derived by concrete computations. So for the matrix product states, I index them with a K here, which is a dimension of this representation that appeared in the classical fields. But these overlap formulas, they have a number of elements which are always the same. They have a factor which is what one calls the super determinant of the Gödel matrix. I will explain in a little while how that is defined, but it's something which is defined in time in terms of the Gödel matrix and only refers to the beta eigenstate. Then in front of this super determinant, one has a ratio of Baxter polynomials, which are polynomials that have beta roots as zeros. And then for matrix product states, one can have some sum in addition of Baxter polynomials, where the sum goes typically from minus k over 2 to k over 2. And that's something which looks as eigenvalue of some transfer matrix of the spin chain. But actually, for the valence bond states, you get something somewhat simpler. You again get a super determinant of the Gödel matrix, some ratio of Baxter polynomials, but there will be no sums involved. And therefore, I will focus from now on understanding the structure of overlap formulas with valence bond states for super spin chains. And I will investigate the transformation properties of these overlap formulas under fermionic and bosonic dualities. And as I said, these valence bond states are also used as initial steps in proofs of general overlap formulas, and therefore it is indeed interesting to study their transformation properties. Okay, this was just a slide about the Gödel determinant. As I said earlier, integrable boundary states are characterized by being annihilated by all the parity or conserved charges of the spin chain. Then that implies that there's only an overlap with beta eigenstates if these beta eigenstates have roots if their momentum pairing roots are paired in plus minus pairs, which again imply that all the auxiliary roots, those which do not carry momentum, also needs to be paired, possibly with extra zero roots being around. But this structure of the roots implies that the Gödel matrix has a block structure, which again implies that its determinant factorizes in two parts. And it's a ratio between these two parts here, which enter in the definition of the superdeterminant. And as I said, this superdeterminant is something which always appears in the overlap formulas. So some non-dynamical part, which refers only to the beta eigenstate. Okay. So here are some examples of concrete overlap formulas. If we start from the SU2 spin chain and consider this simple valence bond state, then the overlap squared takes this form here. We have the super determinant of the Gödel matrix and then some simple ratio of Baxter polynomial. It's a quite compact formula, which is true for any beta eigenstate. So I say this is a square, so in principle, I should also put square on all the following formula, but I just remove the square for simplicity. So if you really want to overlap, you should take square roots over there. But this SU2 result, it has a nice generalization to SU3. The SU3 case corresponds to a Lie algebra with two nodes in the Dinkin diagram, and there are then two different Q functions. And it turns out that you get a ratio of Q functions of the same type as up here, but one for each node. Very nice. And that generalizes also to SU4 or equivalent to this SU6. There we have a Dinkin diagram with three nodes, and we typically are interested in a representation which is characterized by a Dinkin label living on the middle node. And here again, we get the same ratio between the Baxter polynomial appearing in the free factor. And of course, easy to conjecture what it would be in the general case. But as I said, for n equals 4 super Young Mills, we need to go to a super spin chain. And the simplest example of a super spin chain is one based on the Lie algebra SU2/1 that encodes conformal operators which are built from one complex scalar and two fermions. And the relevant valence bond states for n equals 4 super Young Mills, the defects would look like this. And now I write down the overlap formula using this Dynkin diagram for the supervia. And you see the overlap formula has the same elements, but the combination of pure functions which appear is different from the bosonic case. There's clearly a difference from a node being fermionic and a node being bosonic. And we would like to understand the general structure for a more general view of the bond. Actually, we know the result for the full n equals 4 superspin chain, which, as I said, corresponds to a Dynkin diagram with 7 nodes. In that case, the overlap takes this formula here. It was derived, at least implicitly, in a paper by Beinert and Bomba last year. It has again the superdeterminant, which is of course now a complicated object coming from a huge matrix with many blocks. And then there's a prefactor consisting only of vector polynomials, which have only arguments either 0 or I over 2. And these vector polynomials, they are numbered consecutively along the spin chain. So Q1 is related to this node, Q2, Q3, and so on. And now when you see this result, there are of course a number of questions which pose themselves. First of all, how do we compare this result to the previous results for the bosonic spin chains, where we had, for instance, for the SO6 spin chain, a description based on this Dynkin diagram, and even for the SO2/1, where we had a description based on this diagram. Because none of these diagrams are actually sub-diagrams of the general Dynkin diagram up here. So how do we translate this overlap formula from this Dynkin diagram to another one? Another question is, of course, what does this expression look like in the other gradings that one likes for English for surveillance, the beauty or the beast diagram? Of course, the one-point functions in the field theory that we compute are the same, but the way in which they're expressed in terms of the gradient rapidities are different in the different descriptions. And that is what I want to understand. Okay, so in order to understand that, I want to see how these overlap formulas behave under fermionic and bosonic dualities. So I have to introduce these dualities, and to do that, let me start with the integrable SU2/1 superspin chain. This is, as I said, a spin chain when it encodes a good conformal sync phase operators, which are built from one complex scalar and two fermions. In the sports surveillance. And let me start by the antibody described with this Cartan matrix and choose a spin representation given by this Dynkin label. Then the Dynkin diagram looks like this. And I have, as I've explained, one Baxter polynomial associated with each node, Q1 and Q2. I have a set of beta roots associated with one each node, Uis here and Vjs here. And then I have K1, UIs, and K2, VJs. And similarly for more complicated Dynkin diagrams. Here is what the Baxter polynomials look like. As I said, they have the beta roots as zeros. We need an additional trivial Baxter polynomial, which is simply U to the L, and which is called Q theta for historical reasons. As I already said, or maybe I didn't, this description of the spin chain corresponds to a case where the vacuum consists of the fermionic field, one of the fermionic fields, say Psi1. And then we have at the first level of excitations, the Psi2, and at the second level, we have a X. Okay. So a fermionic duality is at the level of field equations, it's simply a change of variables which take you from a description in one. Using one Dynkin diagram to a description using another Dynkin diagram. So let me start from this description here that I already had from the previous slide, the slide. And as I explained, from knowing the Cartan matrix and the Dynkin labels, I can write down directly the beta equations. So here I have written them down for this Dynkin diagram. There's one for each node. And you can write them down as product over beta roots, and that's what we often see, but you can write them more compactly in terms of Baxter polynomials. So here I have used Baxter polynomials to save some space. So here is the beta equations which correspond to the fermionic node here. There are no interactions between, self-interactions between the Vs. That's a sign of being fermionic. And down here, I've written down the beta equations corresponding to the first bosonic node. And here, there are some self-interactions between beta roots. And the notation here with the minus and the plus means that I have shifted the argument of the functions by plus or minus I or two. So what the fermionic duality amounts to is a change of variable in the beta equations. More precisely, I write take this vector polynomial Q1 and write Q1 of V minus Q1 with plus of Q1 minus V minus Q1 plus of V as a new polynomial. And if Q1 has degree K1, then this polynomial has degree K1 minus 1. So it has K1 minus 1 roots. And we know K2 of them, those are the Vs, Vjs. And then I denote the remaining K2 tilde ones as V tildes. And my fermionic duality is the change of variables from the Vs to the V tildes in the beta equations. And now one uses this QQ relation to eliminate the untilted V roots in the beta equations. And the way one does it is by rewriting this relation in a smart way and evaluating it for smart choices of arguments. And when one does that, one finds that the beta equation for the second node takes the same form in the tilde variables as in the untilted ones. And the second beta equation can be rewritten so that these two first factors here actually are expressed entirely in terms of the tilted vector polynomial. That is the vector polynomials which are expressed in terms of the tilted leaves. So this shows that this first node has now become fermionic because now there are no self-interactions between the roots, because here the roots only interact with the tildes. Okay, so effectively, I've gone from a description using this thinking diagram to a agreement description using this diagram here by a change of variables. And now I'm interested in finding out how does my transformation formula transform under this change of variables. Okay, so again, a change between this thinking diagram and this one by my fermionic duality. And yeah, if the number of excitations on the two nodes are even, then the dual number of excitations on the second row node after the transformation is odd, which means that the tilted roots contain a single zero. And then it's nicer to rewrite the QQ relation in a form where you factor out this single zero. And then work with some Baxter polynomials, which do not involve the zero roots. These Baxter polynomials are the ones that will appear in the following, and they're this reduced Baxter polynomials. But now one can try to find out how the superdeterminant, which was a key element of the overlap formula, transforms under such a duality transformation. And one finds that it transforms in this interesting way here. The transformation formula can be expressed entirely in terms of Q functions. So this is the determinant before the transformation, and the tilde one is the one after the transformation. And this is something that has found analytically or numerically, or semi-numerically with some analytical insights. We have not been able to complete an analytical proof yet, but it is in progress. But there are several things one can notice that are interesting. Namely, this transformation rule here, it holds actually semi-unsure, meaning that the U, I's, the roots at the first node, they can be chosen at random, but the V's at the second node that we do analyze after, they then have to fulfill this relation. So that is what we mean by semi-unsure. The U's don't have to fulfill the beta equations. And you also see that we have potentially a very nice covariant transformation formula if our overlap formula always depends on the superdeterminant in combination with the Baxter polynomial Q2. Because then after the transformation, this formula already has killed all the untilted V roots. And we don't need to mess anymore with the original variables. Then there's this prefactor, but this is a factor that we know signals that under this duality transformation, one has reshuffled the multiplets of the V group, so that the highest weight states are mapped to the sentence. And this we know because we have calculated overlaps of the sentence states and other connections and seen that they always contain some combinatorial factors in front of Baxter polynomials. Okay. Now, this was just a familiarity for a two-node thinking diagram, but one can do it more generally. And actually, fermionic dualities, they allow you to move between any two thinking diagrams of a super-Lie algebra. If you do it steps by steps, dualizing one node at a time. And when you do that, the procedure actually involves only the node that you dualize after and its two neighbors. That's because the Cartan matrix for these Lie algebras that I consider are always pre-diagonal. So not all the field roots are involved in the transformation. Then one can convince oneself that this duality transformation, it always changes the nature of the neighboring node to the node that we dualize after. And it also changes the connections, the type of connections between the nodes. And here my notation is related to the sign of the off-diagonal thinking elements in the Cartan matrix. Then one has to worry about whether the node that one dualizes is momentum carrying or non-momentum carrying. In the non-momentum carrying case, it turns out that all thinking labels are unchanged. And in the momentum carrying case, some thinking labels change. If we take a simple example where only the node that we dualize after has a thinking label, then the thinking labels change like this under the duality transformation. But you can see there's a finite number of cases that one has to look into. And this we can do more systematically. So here I have looked at a non-momentum carrying node. So I wrote down the part of the Cartan matrix which is relevant for dualizing this node here in the middle that I know as M. The one to the right I didn't know as R and the one to the left as L. So there's a zero in the Cartan matrix because the node is fermionic, and there's a zero thinking label here in the middle. By definition. Then one can go through various cases, considering various parities of the number of excitations as the various nodes. The simplest case is if all excitation numbers are even, then it's as before that the dual roots has an odd number, and it must extract the zero root from the vector number. But at the end of the day, by numerical investigations, we can again divide a transformation formula for the superdeterminant. And it involves, again, a ratio of Baxter polynomials. Now there are four polynomials involved. There are two in the numerator, which involve the node that we dualize after, the middle node, and two in the denominator, which involve the node at the right and the node at the right, at the left. And you see, again, there are only arguments 0 and IO2 everywhere. Then there's a combinatorial prefactor, which depends on the local environment in the Cartan matrix, which is quite obvious. If the neighboring nodes have the opposite parity, if the middle node has an odd number of excitations, well, then it corresponds to doing the transformation in the opposite direction, and we get this free factor here to the power minus 1. Okay, we don't need to bother so much with the details, but then one can go through all the cases where the dualized mode is momentum carrying. That means that the thinking label has a non-zero element here in the mid. It could also have some non-zeros at the two other places here, but we don't need that for our considerations of any of these four polynomials. There's also some general form of the part of the Cartan matrix, which is relevant that you can write down completely generically. But at the end of the day, you get a transformation formula which looks precisely as for the non-momentum carrying case, at least as when it comes to the Baxter polynomials which appear. There's a slightly different prefactor, which of course depends on the thinking label of the dualized node. But again, this is something that we found numerically and would love to prove, but have not proven yet. I should say that if the excitation number at the neighboring nodes are odd, then you need to regularize the Bang matrix, and there's a lot actually of working around with regularizations in this, but in the end of the day we get a nice formula in all cases, a formula which I have summarized here. So the superdeterminant on the fermionic duality transformation, it transforms into this ratio of Baxter polynomials times to be determined in the new variables. And we see here that we have the possibility of a very nice covariant transformation formula if our overlap formulas always involve the Baxter polynomial Q of the dualized node in combination with the superdeterminant. Because then after dualization, we have eliminated totally all the roots which have been dualized. So this I have represented here. If we have Q A of zero for the node that we dualize after in the numerator, that's what this notation means. Then after dualization, I will end up with Q of zero in the denominator and then additional two Qs in the numerator at the neighboring side. Plus one times I O two. Another way to have something covariant is, of course, if we go the other way and start out from Baxter polynomial in the denominator and end up with it in the numerator and in the denominator the two neighboring points. So if we require that our overlap formula transforms covariantly, there are not very many possibilities for how it can look like. And maybe this is something which could be used to constrain overlap formulas in various cases. Certainly, it turns out that the overlap formula for n equals 4 super Young-Mills theory has exactly the form that we would like it to have in order to transform covariantly. It has exactly one factor of the Baxter polynomial with argument Q, argument 0 in the denominator for each fermionic node. And that means that we can directly perform a dualist transformation and get rid of all the original variables. So if we want, for instance, to transform for this alternator grading to the UD thinking diagram, we can do it in two steps. We first dualize after the outermost nodes. That moves the Q functions from the numerator to the denominator and adds some additional Q functions in the numerator at neighboring nodes and turn these neighboring nodes to fermionic nodes. Then in a second step, we can dualize after these new fermionic nodes and goes in the same way. We replace a Q function in the denominator by a Q function in the numerator and then some additional Q function in the denominator as neighboring nodes. Then we end up with this formula, which now gives us the overlap formula in the beauty description of the spin chain. And this is extremely nice. First of all, because our transformation formula exactly transforms covariantly. And secondly, because this gives us a result which actually coincides with the results that we divide later for the bosonic issue before spin chain, which corresponds to this inner part of the thinking platform. Okay. Now, but these fermionic
variables. I think you have a few minutes left, right? Yes.
Yes. I'm almost done.
Yes.
So these fermionic dualities, they are actually just a part of a web of dualities that we have for integrable superspin chains. And here I have illustrated this web of dualities for integrable SU1 slash 2 spin chain. So in total, you actually have 2 to 3 Q functions. Two of them are fixed to provide the boundary conditions. That means that there are 6 left. And you can plot them in a diagram like this, where the 2 fixed ones are at the bottom and the top. And then you can describe each formulation of the Beta equation as a path which goes from the top bottom node to the top node. And there are exactly 6 such paths, and they correspond to various different ways you can choose what is the vacuum for the spin chain and what is excitation at the first levels. And that is exactly 6 the different choices that we have. And the fermionic duality that I have considered so far, it corresponds to flipping this blue path across a vertical face and leading to this red diagram here. You see the Dinky nodes of the nodes of the Dinky diagram corresponds to the corner of this tube. But in this picture, we have additional dualities which corresponds to flipping or path across a horizontal face. That would correspond to a bosonic duality and change this blue path to a green path. And this does not imply any change of Feynman of a thinking diagram, but still implies a change of variables. And then of course, the question is, how do overlap formulas, and in particular the superdeterminant transform under such transformations. Here I have done a warm-up example with the SU2 spin chain, where we have only 4 Q functions, 2 of them constituting boundary conditions, and 1 that we normally use. We then have 1 QQ relation, which defines us a new dual Baxter polynomial. And we can find how the superdeterminant of the Banach matrix transforms under this bosonic duality transformation. You see that, again, it transforms in a way with 4 Baxter polynomials. Now there's only 1 polynomial, so we have no indices. But in this case, there are 2 tilted and 2 untilted ones. And here you see that if the overlap to begin with contains the Q of 0 over Q of I over 2 times the superdeterminant, then it will stay invariant under this bosonic duality transformation. And that is exactly what happens for the SU2 spin chain. It also happens, you can also look at more general bosonic dualities. Then you would also have to look at the 3-node thinking diagram. But in this case, it's really simple. The duality transformation does not change the thinking diagram or the thinking labels. But you still have to distinguish between momentum carrying and non-momentum carrying bosonic nodes. But in all cases, you get a transformation formula for the superdeterminant that depends only on the Baxter polynomial associated with the node that we dualize us after. And the neighboring nodes only appear via the combinatorial free factor, which I gave it on the previous slide. Here, only the number of excitations at the neighboring nodes appear. And if the node is non-momentum carrying, the length does not even appear in the combinatorial factor. Yes, there we are. Yeah, I mean to say that the overlaps in the maximal scalar subsector of any Sposobianian system, the SO6 sector, is actually invariant under these bosonic dualities, which is a nice result. So, by summary, we have exhausted all fermionic and bosonic spin chain dualities, and we found their implications for overlap formulas. And in particular, we have seen that the overlap formula of relevance for any Sposobianian has very nice covariant transformation properties under fermionic dualities. What we would still like to do is to analytically prove these duality transformation formulas. It appears that they are extremely easy to state. They involve just some determinants and some polynomials, but they are much harder to prove. And we have not completed any of the proofs yet, not even in the simplest cases. Then we would also really like to understand the prefactors in the various transformation formulas. It's all about some group theory and representation gymnastics, but it would be nice to have a crystal clear understanding of what is going on. And finally, we would like to express the overlap entirely in terms of Q functions, that is getting rid of this superdeterminant of the Gödel matrix, because that would allow us to treat the overlaps and the one-point functions by a method known as this quantum spectral curve, which is a method that we can use to get non-perturbative information about quantum quantities of in Nichols force superiormic theory, but it requires that you can express them in terms of cube functions to begin with. So that's all. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. So are there any questions?
I have one quick question. Can I ask this?
Yeah, sure. Please.
So Kolya Abramov had some recent Q functions for a rank for a higher rank that did not use the auxiliary beta roots at all. So I don't know if you know his construction, where he manages to study higher rank spin chain, but he used some slightly unconventional Q functions, if I remember correctly. Or maybe I'm confused. Maybe it's slightly unconventional B operators. But basically, my question is, whether those developments from the separation of variables and the things that he was doing, if they are useful for this
certainly the separation of variables approach is very interesting. That's another way one could try to go.
Mm-hmm. I see. But you did not find if some formulas are simpler in those variables.
Well, we have worked with the standard Baxter polynomials, as I have explained. We have not exploited that avenue.
Okay, thank you.
More questions for the speaker? So do you have a classification of those boundaries, integrable boundary states?
Not really a complete classification. I don't think that integrable boundary states are really classified, but we definitely have met these two types of integrable boundary states. And we have a characterization of what we mean by an integrable boundary state, and one, there could be more types of states that fulfill this.
Thank you. So if there are no further questions, let us thank the speaker again. And I suggest that we make a 5 minutes break and we resume at 35 minutes past the hour. Thank you.